Morning.
Good morning.
We want to welcome you to our service this morning. We join together rejoicing and praising God and celebrating what God is doing in our midst. A few announcements to draw to your attention. Men's group meeting Thursday, 10:30 at CANOE COVE Church. Women's group will be meeting here at the church Tuesday at 10 o'clock, so please note those two dates. Bible study for the charge begins October the 15th. At 1 o'clock at CANOE COVE Church, and then Sunday, October 18th at 7 o'clock here at Clyde River. We're going to be looking at various denominations within the Christian faith. So we're going to actually start with our own. We're going to start with the Reformed churches, including Presbyterian Church, Christian Reformed Church, and also Church of Scotland. So that'll begin, and then we'll make our way through some of the other denominations within the Christian community as we look at the history and background, some of the differences and similarities to what we hold as Presbyterians. Other announcements are, I was going to say in your bulletin, but they're not in your bulletin. Youth group. Youth group began on Friday evening. Our next one will be in 2 weeks' time. I believe it'll be on October the 16th. The junior group will be meeting again here at Clyde River Church from 6:30 to 7:30. We are looking at having a senior group this year, and that'll be for young people in junior high, so grades 7, 8, and 9. There'll be more information to come. We're looking at possibly having a meeting on October the 23rd. There'll be more information to follow on that. Other information you can find on our Facebook page. There's a lot of information on there. A thank you to David, to Alan, and to Lloyd, who helped with the wheelchair ramp. They were fixing that yesterday, and they were also fixing a few posts that were broken off as well. So big thank you to the three of them for their work. And also, we do want to extend congratulations to Dougie and Sylvia McCaffrin from our sister church in CANOE COVE, for as they celebrated recently their 66th wedding anniversary. So big congratulations to Dougie and Sylvia on that. And also a happy birthday to Lloyd as he celebrates a birthday. A special birthday? 75th. Oh, 75th. So there you go. So big celebration to Lloyd. And so if you see him around, say happy birthday to him. I'm sure he'll appreciate this being on YouTube too. We're going to join together now as we share our call to worship. That's okay, I think I lost my mask now. Oh,
here. Damn, on the other side. Now the other side of the pole.
Oh, good.
Underneath.
Oh.
Instead of underneath.
Underneath the pole?
Yeah. Oh. Under the pole.
Oh, there it is. Yeah. I don't have a lot of editing to do in our service today. There, we're all better now. Bless the Lord at all times.
May God's grace be continually in your mouth.
Magnify the Lord with me.
Let us exalt the name of the Lord together.
Seek the Lord and be filled.
Those who seek the Lord.
Let's turn to him now in prayer. Let us pray. Wondrous, gracious, and loving God, we thank you that we can worship, that we can praise, and that we can glorify your name. We come to celebrate the good news and the hope of Christ. We come to rejoice in all the blessings that you have poured out upon us, that overflow in our lives, that reveal your love, care, and compassion to us. May we in this time worship you and glorify your name. May we draw ever closer to you and to one another. And may we know the strength that you offer to us through your word and through Christ the living word. Lift us up now as we worship, as we praise, and as we glorify together your name this day and in the days to come. Amen. We're now going to join together. We're going to sing to God's glory the hymn, Come Thou Fount. Remember, mask on. If you find it.
Come now, come now, glory, glory.
We now prepare to share the word of God together, and as we do, we're going to draw our hearts close to him. Let us pray. Loving God, your word is timeless. Your word speaks to us. Your word reminds us of how close you are to us and how you want us to draw even closer to you. We thank you for the power of your word. We thank you for how it reveals who you are to us and how you desire us to walk in your steps and in your path. Be with us as we worship. Be with us as we share your word. Be with us as we live your word in the world around us. For your word is not only to be heard, but to be lived. Sustain us, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Our responsive reading this morning is taken from Psalm 80, reading verses 7 through 14. Restore us, O God Almighty. Make your face to shine upon us, that we may be saved.
You are the sun and the nations.
You cleared the ground for it, and it took root and filled the land.
The mountains are covered with shade, and the mighty cedars with branches.
It sent out its boughs to the sea, its shoots as far as the river.
Why have you broken down its walls?
Boars from the forest ravage it, and the creatures of the field feed on it.
Return to us, O Almighty. Look down from heaven and see. Watch over this time.
Our next portion of scripture is taken from Isaiah chapter 5. Isaiah 5, verses 1 through 6. I will sing for the one I love a song about his vineyard. My loved one had a vineyard on a fertile hillside. He dug it up and cleared it of stones and planted it with choicest vines. He built a watchtower in it and cut out a wine press as well. Then he looked for a crop of good grapes, but it yielded only bad fruit. Now you dwellers in Jerusalem and men of Judea, judge between me and my vineyard. What more could I have done for my vineyard than I have already done for it? When I looked for good grapes, why did it yield only bad? Now I will tell you what I am going to do to my vineyard. I will take away its hedge, and it will be destroyed. I will break down its walls, and it will be trampled. I will make it a wasteland, neither pruned nor cultivated. And briars and thorns will grow there. I will command the clouds not to rain on it. Amen, and may God's word speak to us today as we share his word together. We're now going to lift our voices again once in praise to God as we sing the hymn, Tell Me the Old, Old Story.
Jesus, send his love.
This morning we're going to be looking at a portion of scripture from the book of the prophet Isaiah. We're going to be talking about vineyards and planting and gardening, which I don't like very much. I'm not a gardener. I do not have a green thumb. Anything I look at will probably wither away. That's just the reality, and I'm quite happy to acknowledge that. Flowers look lovely as long as I don't have to tend them. Corn is delicious as long as I'm not the one having to plant it and water it and care for it. And it's interesting, and I think maybe that's part of the reason why I'm not a big gardener. It takes time. And I am, by my very nature, not a terribly patient fellow. Most of you know that by now. That's why I don't fish either. I just, if I can buy a fish at a store, great. If I can buy corn at a store, great. But for people who love fishing, for people who love gardening, God bless you. It is a gift, I believe. And it is interesting because we live on PEI, so of course we know all about planting and crops and gardening. We know all about the joys and the sorrows of a good crop and a bad crop. We know all about putting our heart and soul into our crop only to see something happen to it. That's the reality of being a farmer. You can only do so much, and then it's out of your hands. This morning, we see the prophet Isaiah speaking of the vineyard. He's speaking of a vineyard, and in this vineyard, we see that the vineyard owner is God. The vineyard owner, the one who cares for the vineyard, the one who loves his vineyard, is God. And the vineyard and the people of Israel, the children of Israel. And what we see in this portion of scripture is one that is very illuminating in terms of how we see God and how we experience God. Scripture tells us that he has a vineyard on a very fruitful hill. He dug it up, cleared out the stones, planted it with the choicest vines. He built a tower in the midst, made a wine press. He did everything he could. This is an indication to us of how much God loves us, how much God cares for us, and how far God will go for us. Isaiah begins by reminding us that we are loved by God, that God will go to any lengths for us, and to show us how much he cares, how much he loves us. God's love is not limited to a time and a place. God puts his heart and soul into each one of us because we are his. We are his creation. We are his people. And he pours himself into us. A lot of times, I think we forget that. A lot of times, when we find ourselves in uncertain situations or circumstances, we think we are by ourselves. We think that we have no value. We think we have no purpose. We think that no one cares. In beginning this portion of scripture, Isaiah is reminding us that that's not the case. He's reminding us that we are cared for. We are loved, that God goes this far and even farther. Just when you think God has gone far enough, he goes even farther. He shows us new ways in which he loves us and cares for us and reminds us that no matter what we are facing, no matter the issues in our lives, God sees you for who you are, but also for who you can be, for who he sees you be. And that's an encouragement for us, because he sees better than we see. Because he's the one who has created us. He is the one who has planted us. And he is the one who wants to stand by us and nurture us. You see, seeing God as the farmer, as the gardener, is a very, very good way of looking at God. Because it reveals his patience with us. But it also reminds us that it takes a while to come to fulfillment, to bear fruit. A lot of times we want things to happen immediately, right away. When in reality, it takes time, it takes effort, and it takes a lot of hard work. It doesn't happen overnight. We don't plant a seed one day, and the next day we have a crop of carrots or lettuce or whatever it might be. It takes time. In the same way, it takes time for us to develop and deepen our faith with God. And the great thing is, he is there. When we stumble and fall, he is there. When we're unsure of which way to turn, he is there. When we need shelter from the storms of life, he is there. When we need to feel the warmth of the sun, he is there. And Isaiah is reminding the people of Israel who are hearing this word, this is what God has done for you. God has taken you out of Egypt. God has taken you out of slavery. He has taken you to the promised land. This is what he wants for you. He wants what's good for you. He wants to bless you. And he'll go to any means necessary to see that happen. And yet, Isaiah tells us these words. That the grapes that were grown were not good grapes. Now, the New King James, the King James Version, has wild grapes, also bad grapes. These grapes that should have been so wonderful, so great, were not so great. But it's not for what God did or didn't do. We see in verse we see these words in verse 3 and verse 4. What more could have been done to my vineyard that I have not done in it? In other words, it's a reminder that God has gone to the end and beyond. He's gone as far as he could, and then he goes a bit farther. What more could I have done? You saw everything I've done. And yet, the fruit is still bad. In other words, it was a wake-up call to the people of Israel. It's a wake-up call to the people of Israel that the onus is on them. Not on God, on them. That God has done everything he could, and he did even more, to show them how much they were loved, how much they were cared for, how much he wanted to draw them even closer to himself, and they decided not to. They made the choice, they made the decision to turn away from God. And it broke God's heart. Gardening, being a vineyard owner, is difficult. It's not easy. And what Isaiah is saying is that for God, this was not easy. It hurt him. It broke him. Because his people turned away from him. It wasn't for lack of effort on God's part. But the people of God just didn't get it. they didn't understand. This morning, the Sesame Street character we're looking at is Grover. Now, Grover is a well-loved character in Sesame Street. Some would argue he's probably one of the most popular characters in Sesame Street. But he, like a lot of Muppets, didn't get their start on Sesame Street. Grover originally appeared in the Ed Sullivan Show on Christmas Eve in 1967. Good way to start if you're a little Muppet. And he appeared there, but his name also wasn't Grover. His name was Gleep. Grover sounds much better if you ask me. And then when Sesame Street began in 1969, Grover began to appear on that very first year. But he wasn't the blue furry monster we know today. His fur was much darker, and he went by the nickname Fuzzy Face. Again, not a great nickname. But by 1970, he became the monster we know him as today. That cute, furry little monster. Your furry little pal, Grover. And from there, the rest is history. Now, Grover loved to help people. But in reality, we know he isn't very good at it. He means well, but he usually ends up very poorly. Grover has many different personas on Sesame Street. He has Waiter Grover, who we saw a few weeks ago. He has Super Grover, who we will see in a few more weeks. And Global Grover, which I'm guessing is a Grover that came and appeared after I stopped watching Sesame Street, because I don't remember Global Grover. But today we're going to look at a different Grover. We're going to be looking at Gardner Grover. And what we will see in this clip is, well, Grover, pure and simple. Someone who means well, but it doesn't quite work out as well as he expects.
Greetings, all you nature lovers. This is your cute, furry, blue, and green-thumbed gardening monster, Grover. And today, I am going to tell you about the things that all cute little plants need to grow and stay healthy. Well, first they need soil and sunlight, which this plant over here already has plenty of. But a plant also needs to eat. Okay, little plenty, I hope you are hungry because, oh, have I got a treat for you. Something that all little plants love, and that is a big, healthful salad with radishes and tomatoes, oh, and just a hint of oregano. Bon appetit! Do not wait for me, I have already eaten. What? It appears this plant is not of the salad eating variety. But fear not, I know what else a little plant needs to grow big and healthy. A pizza! Oh, piping hot, fresh out of the oven. What? Oh dear, this little plant does not seem to be a pizza eater either. But being the resourceful gardening monster that I am, I know just the thing that no little plant can resist. Hungarian goulash! Ah, oh, enjoy! Do not resist! Give in to temptation! Or not. Oh, I got vault. I cannot believe this little plant is one finicky eater. And how will it ever grow to be big and healthy and green and... And now it is raining. Oh, the weather report did not forecast rain today. But look! Oh, the little plant is looking nice and healthy again. Oh! I guess all it needed was a little water. And I guess what I really need right now is an umbrella. Excuse me. Do you mind?
So as you can see from the clip, Grover tried to feed the plants, but it didn't work out. Because he tried to feed them in a way that he never should have done. It wasn't the right way to do it. And so we struggle, because a lot of times that's what we try to do. We try to do God's work for Him. We try to do God's work in such a way that we think we are doing what is right. We want to take ownership of the vineyard instead of allowing God to be the owner of the vineyard. And the reality is, if we try to take ownership of that vineyard, we will only see the vineyard wither away. Because God's ways are not our ways. God's ways are greater than ours. We may not like what God is saying. We may not like what God is directing us to do. We may not like where God is pointing us to go. But at the end of the day, it comes down to whether or not we trust God, whether or not we have faith in God, and whether or not we believe that we are the gardeners or God is. And that's something only we can answer. It's something only you and I can answer. Are we willing to allow God to garden or not? It's hard. Because when God's the gardener, He is going to do some pruning. Now, I'm not a gardener, as you know. But I'm quite happy to start hacking and chopping away at things. As Lisa can attest, sometimes my pruning skills leave a lot to be desired, and sometimes there are innocent plants that get, well, they're no longer with us anymore. But pruning, when done well and competently, actually helps plants to grow, actually helps things to flourish, helps things to blossom and bloom. Out of the pruning comes new life, comes a sense of expectation, a sense of joy, a sense of hope, a sense of renewed purpose and vision. It's interesting here that as Isaiah tells us in verse 6, we see that God is no longer going to prune. In other words, He's allowing the vineyard to be taken over. He's allowing those branches that no longer have life to choke out the ones that do. You see, when God is caring for us, sometimes it means that God will have to prune back our lives. That He will ask us to rid ourselves of situations or circumstances or things or people in our lives that are holding us back, that are causing us to move away from God instead of moving to God. And pruning is not easy, because it means letting go. It means letting go of maybe something we love, perhaps something we love even more than God. It means letting go and moving from where we are comfortable to where we may not be comfortable, in order for God to start something new, in order for God to renew our spirit, to renew our hope, to renew our faith, to renew us as His people. The children of Israel didn't want that renewal. They turned their back from God and have decided to go their own way. And we as a church face the very same issue. As a church, are we willing to allow God to move in our midst? Are we allowing God to prune us, to trim us, so that we might then go into the world with a new sense of vision, a new sense of purpose, a new dynamic vision that allows God to be seen, to be heard, to be experienced by the world around us? Are we willing to step outside our comfort zone? Are we willing to step out of where we feel safe so that the gospel of Christ might be shared, so that the vineyard that God is planting continues to grow? A lot of times we like our little vineyard. A lot of times we are comfortable in our little vineyard. But the reality is that God's desire is to not have a stay in that little vineyard. God's desire is to see that vineyard grow and grow and grow. But to do that and to allow that to happen means we have to let God work. It means we have to let God move. The Israelites struggled with that. They really, really struggled with that. To the point we know that they were sent into exile. To the point that they were cut off from God. But even then, God still did not forget about them. God still loved them and cared for them and wanted to bring them back home. God's love knows no limits or bounds. But just as Isaiah warned the Israelites, he warns us. We need to let God move. We need to let God be the gardener instead of trying to do it by ourselves. We need to let God prune our lives, trim back those things that are holding us back. It may feel difficult. It may feel hard at first. But in the end, it will reveal a new way and a new path for us. The Greek word for prunes also means clean. And in pruning, God is clean. God is tidying. God is creating again among his people. And that's what we want him to do. That's our desire for him to do. And so may we let God be our gardener, knowing that we are in good hands, knowing that we are loved, and knowing that he wants a vineyard, alive and well and vibrant, proclaiming and living the good news of Jesus Christ and him alone. Amen. We're going to join now in a time of prayer and ask if there's any prayer requests this morning.
Pray for Colleen.
Pray for Alana Hill.
Alana. Let's turn to God. Let us pray. We come, O God, knowing that you have called us to unity. We come, O God, knowing that our world has changed and continues to change even this day. We know that as we gather as your churches across the globe, that this is to be World Communion Sunday, a time when we gather at your table to share the bread and the wine, to remember the sacrifice of your Son. And still today, even though the opportunity to gather at your table is limited, we are still mindful of the unity that is found in Christ, that is found around his table. And we ask, O God, that on this Sunday we will feel your strength, we will feel your presence, and we will be mindful that you are the one who is our gardener. You are the one who tends to us, who cares for us, who ministers to us. You are the one who takes time and who does not give up on us, even when we feel like giving up on ourselves. You are the one who sees our potential. You are the one who sees our promise. And you are the one who loves us enough to prune us, to trim us, to point out to us what is holding us back, what is keeping us from you. Give to us ears to hear. Give to us eyes to see. Give to us hearts that are tender. Give to us feet that will move, and give to us a mouth that will proclaim the hope and love of Jesus Christ. Gracious God, we thank you. We thank you for the work you have done thus far in our vineyard. Forgive us when we try to take over ownership. Forgive us when we try to do our own thing. Forgive us when we try to plant the seed. Forgive us when we are not willing to wait. Give to us patience. Give to us the strength to let go and to allow you to move. Be with us. Speak to us. Loving God, hear the prayers of your people this morning hour. Gracious God, we hear your prayers this day, just as you hear our prayers to you. We think of Colleen, Alana, we think of Arthur, we think of Larry, we think of Vera, and we ask, O God, for your blessing to be poured out upon each one, that you will be their strength as well as our strength, that you will reveal your grace and your love. May you continue to encourage them, just as you encourage each one of us to follow you, to seek you, and to know that we are loved by you. Sustain us now, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning is Love Lifted Me.
Thank you.
God does desire to lift us up. He desires to lift us up and carry us to where we need to go. He is our strength, our rock, and our protector. He is the one who is our gardener, who wants to tend to us and surround us with his love, to develop us to be the people he calls us to be, so that we can proclaim the good news of Christ. May we go in the grace, love, and mercy of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, both now and forevermore. Amen.